I'm not sure what I mean, but I would say Siddhartha, well, maybe I'm Gollum. I'm just changing personalities, going around. Sometimes I'm a physicist, sometimes I'm a neuroscientist, but I'm always far from the ring. So basically the talk today is like the 1% of the talks I tend to give. So 99% of the talks I ever give, I will show data, and I will say there are a lot of technical details, but don't worry about them. I mean, let's really go into what these neurons mean, what are they doing, and what are the role in memory, and so on. So this talk will be like the part of the minority, so will be like 1% of the talk, where we will say, no, now let's really look into the details. So today we will look into the details of how we get the data and so on. The story I want to tell you has two parts. So there are two stories in one lecture, but they are quite linked. The first story is spike sorting, and the second story is simulation of recordings. And before we get into the slides and so on, let me try to frame the question, to frame the two stories. So as you know, let me start by asking, how many of you are physicists? Well, so it's more, well, about half. And the other half, I mean, you are biologists or neuroscientists or mathematicians maybe. So how many are, let's call it from the biology side, the natural science side? Okay, so it's a bit less than half. When we do recordings, I mean, that goes especially for the physicists, because I guess the biologist knows this very well. When we do recordings, I mean, we're recording from neurons in the brain. No, we know we have like 10 to 11 neurons, 100 million neurons or so. And how can we record activity of neurons from the brain? Well, there's one simple way. If you're going to do it with humans, you put electrodes on top of the scalp, and this is what we call electroencephalography, or you can get magnetic fields, it's what we call magnetoencephalography, or you can get the famous Bolt signal, fMRI, and so on. These are all non-invasive methods, right? Many people use this in cognitive neuroscience. There are zillions of papers using these methods. But you still cannot see neurons, single neurons. I mean, you're seeing the average activity, the common activity of millions of neurons. To see something with an EEG electrode, you need millions of neurons doing something, and this is what you see, the result of this combination of signals from the activity of millions of neurons. If you want to see single neurons, if you really want to see the neurons, you need to get inside the brain. So that's an invasive procedure. You need to do a surgery, and you need to put electrodes. An electrode is nothing more than just a tiny wire, and then you will put this tiny wire inside the brain, you will amplify the signal, and then you will look at the signal. And this is what people are doing in animals since, I don't know, at least half a century or so, since at least the 50s, even more. So that's a quite standard way, and these are called extracellular recordings. You don't need to do extracellular. You can do something more sophisticated. So basically what you do is, imagine you have the brain here, you put an electrode, and then you record the signal that you hear from the neurons. And the neurons, as you know, they fire action potential or spikes, or, I mean, this is a simplification, or they are silent. The neuron does nothing or suddenly goes like, pack, pack, pack. And if the neuron likes something, or the neuron wants to tell a message to other neurons, we go from pack, pack, pack to pa 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 pa. We start fire stronger. So we know that the changes in firing rate or the precise timing of firing code information. Now, how can we get this? Well, we just stick an electrode in the brain, and we listen to the firing of neurons. Now, here comes the first problem. If you put an electrode in the brain, just like that, in gray matter, and you're listening to the firing of neurons, you won't listen to one neuron. You will listen to many. Because you don't have just one neuron firing close to the electrode. You will have a bunch of them. And this is what, in physics or in mathematics, we call, I mean, this analogy to what we call the cocktail party problem. And imagine, we said, well, let's stop our talking about spike sorting, and Siddhartha has a surprise. Suddenly we get caipirinhas for everybody, and we wander around, and we put microphones. And we try to get the conversations of the people based on the microphones. Now, if I put one microphone here, I won't be able to do much, right? Because we're all talking, and all the conversations get mixed with each other. So the solution to this, to the cocktail party problem, is to put many microphones around the room. And then if you combine the signal from many microphones, you will be able, if you're well, I mean, with data processing, you might be able to tell who is saying what. It's a similar problem with the brain. You put a microphone, and if you have a single electrode, you just have one, right? And you have many more neurons than us in this room talking close to this microphone. Now, this is the problem. This is the challenge, no? I mean, how can you tell which firing, which spike corresponds to which neuron? Because they are all talking together, and you have one microphone there in the brain, and you are hearing all of them. How can you separate the voice, let's call it like this, of the different neurons? So this is our first problem. This is what we call a spike sorting. And I will show you how to do that, and I will particularly show you a method to do that. And in the evening, we will have a tutorial, so I will show you how to use the code. So it will be more hands-on. Now, first problem sorted. Well, sorted, no, settled already. Now comes the second problem, right? Imagine that I'm a physicist. Well, I was a physicist, so I come up with a very smart idea. I say, wow, I have it. I can try this, and I can tell apart the voice from this neuron, or the firing from this neuron, from this one, from this one, from this one. I can tell them all apart. And then I show my method, and I say, look, I mean, from your single electrode, I can get 20 neurons. Wow, this is amazing. But then the problem is, well, how do I know you are right? Or how will you know that I'm right with my new clever algorithm? You say, well, maybe you are just making it up. I mean, maybe they are not just 20 neurons. Maybe it's just 2 neurons. And you keep splitting the activity of 2 neurons, and this is wrong. You shouldn't have done that. So how can you tell if I'm right or wrong with my new algorithm? Well, with real data, there are some very smart ways of telling, but in principle, you cannot tell. I mean, you cannot tell if your algorithm is right or wrong. So how can we go around it? If I have an idea and I have a new method that I want to try, how can I tell if my method is good or bad? Well, for this, I go to simulations. So it's very simple. I will try to generate simulated data where I know exactly which neuron is which. And then I will use my algorithm with the simulated data, hopefully as close as possible as real data, and I will try my algorithm, and then I can quantify. Say, oh, I missed this one. Oh, I split this into 2 neurons, and they weren't 2, was the same neuron firing many times, and so on. So then I can quantify. So that's the second problem. The first problem is how to separate the activity from different neurons, and the second problem is, well, how can we simulate data to be able to test these algorithms, right? So we start with the first problem. And I will just show you some slides, but basically the slides are telling in images the same intro I just gave you. So basically you put electrodes inside the brain, I mean, and you record activity from neurons, the firing from neurons, and if you put an electrode here, the data, sorry, I think the ones in the back may not see this, but we look like that. It's basically noise. On top of the noise, you have the firing of the neurons, and this is what we call spikes, right? Because it looks like spikes. This is how the recording looks like. I mean, and this is quite classic. If you see this data, you say, wow, this is a nice recording. I have very nice spikes. The only thing I have done to this data is high-pass filter, and I will show you in a second, I mean, how this works. Okay, now let's see the whole process of data processing in just one slide. So imagine you have, I mean, a patch of cortex, I mean, a bit of cortex in the brain with many neurons around. You put an electrode, and you amplify the data, and the data may look like this. This is actually real data. This is from humans. I will tell you later why we do recording in humans. And you don't see spikes here. You basically see this activity, which we call EEG signal. I mean, it's similar to what you see when you put an electrode in the scalp of the head. Well, not similar, there are some differences, but it looks like that. Now, if you low-pass filter the data, say you say, well, I will get anything below 300 hertz or so, then you get a more or less clean LFP signal. It looks very similar to this one, right? So this is low-pass filter data. Now, if you high-pass filter the data, you can see the spikes. So you get rid of all these, I mean, low-frequency oscillations or deflections or whatever, and then you see the spikes very, very clearly. Right? So you always need to high-pass filter the data, and then you start seeing the spikes. And now, well, you have many spikes here. But you see, for example, this one is a bit larger than these ones here. Well, this is because they're from different neurons. So the first thing you have to do is you have to detect the spikes. You have to tell when there was a spike compared to the noise. And once you detect, you have to separate them. So here comes the first hint of how to do the job of spike sorting. I said, you put the electrode, you're listening to many neurons around you, right? And you have to tell which one is telling what. You have to tell this spike is from this neuron, this spike from the other neurons. How can you tell them apart? Well, because the spike shapes, the shape of each of these spikes is different from different neurons, in principle. It doesn't need to be like that. But in principle, the spike shape from different neurons is different. And the spike from one neuron tends to be consistently similar. It's not exactly always the same, but it's quite similar. So the spike shape is more or less a stereotype for each neuron. So basically, your job as physicists or mathematicians is to say, well, I have to come up with an algorithm to be able to separate the different spike shapes. Why? Well, because that corresponds to the activity of different neurons. And I can tell you here, well, I have three single neurons, and in my sketch here, this will correspond to these three neurons that are very close to the tip of the electrode, right? So you know the electrode only records from the tip. It's, I mean, all the way along is isolated. You only record from the tip. And then you have neurons very far away. These neurons will contribute to the noise activity you see in the data. All this noise is mainly firing of neurons that are too far, right? And then you have neurons that are in between, like this second ring here. And these neurons will give you this type of activity, and this is what we call multi-unit activity. Basically, these are neurons which spikes you can detect, because you can see these are spikes, but they are relatively low, so you cannot tell them apart anymore. So the ones that are very high, you can tell them apart, because you say, no, this one is different from this one, and so on. The ones that are very small, you know that they are spikes, but you cannot separate them, because the noise is too high. So then we give up, and we say, well, we cannot do much better than that, but let's take it and call it multi-unit, right? Okay, so that's a sketch of the process, right? So, and why do neurons have different spike shapes? It's not that a neuron comes with a spike shape imprinted in the neuron. Say, I'm neuron A, and I will have a spike shape like this. I'm neuron, I don't know, a zillion 20, and I will have a spike shape like that. This is due to a biophysical process, and basically, what you are recording is the electrical field around the neuron, right? And the electrical field around the neuron depends on where you are recording from. If I have this neuron, and if I put my electrode here, I will get a different spike shape than if I put my electrode there. And to convince you of this, these are actually simulations done by my former advisor at Caltech, Christoph Koch. He started this in the, ages ago, in the 90s, with a guy called Gary Holt, and then Carl Gold was doing more studies. This is a very nice problem. So basically what you have is the simulation of a neuron. I mean, you see the neuron here, the dendritic tree, and so on. And that's a very interesting problem for physicists, right? How you simulate the activity of a neuron, I mean, and then you have a software called neuron, and then how you simulate the extracellular field you will record from an electrode at all these different positions. So this spike that you see here will be the activity you record if you put the electrode here. This spike that you see here will be the activity recorded if you put the electrode there, and so on. So you have the spike shape at different positions. How do you get the spike shapes? Well, you have to do, I tell you in one sentence, you have to use this neuron code, and then you have to do a cable theory, a line source approximation, and so on. It's a very interesting problem. Now, you can see that depending on where you put your electrode, the spike shape will be completely different. For example, here you have positive and then followed by negative. And here you have a straight negative followed by positive. Now, depending on the orientation of the neuron and the relative position, you will get a different spike shape. Also depending on the physiological characteristics of the neuron, right? So basically you put an electrode, and the neurons are all around there with different dendritic trees, and the dendritic trees will also give you different spike shapes. And this difference here that depends on the relative position plus the contribution from the different dendritic trees of the neurons will give you a stereotype, a spike shape, from the position you're recording at. Is this clear? You follow that? Okay, and here you have different models of neurons, and these are the different spike shapes you get at different positions. Now, again, the job you have to do, and this is a summary of the introduction for the first part of the talk, is you have to detect the spikes, and you have to classify them into different shapes. And the different shapes will correspond to your putative neurons. This is your best guess. You will say, I have neuron 1, neuron 2, neuron 3, and multi-unit, right? All right. Now, a sketch about the simulated data. So I'm giving you like a preview of the spike sorting problem. We will get into details in the second part. And I'll give you a preview of the simulations. If you want to simulate data, I mean, the first naive thing you will do is you say, well, I generate noise, and on top of the noise, I put the spike shapes, I put the spikes that I know, right? So when we, well, when I did this study 10 years ago, I got a database of 600, close to 600 different spike shapes, and the thing that I did was very simple. I was just generating noise and putting the spike shapes of different neurons at different positions. And that will be the data I will use later to test my spike sorting algorithm. So the first thing I did was use noise, white noise. So I gave a talk at a meeting of Caltech, which was where I was at the time, with the Hebrew University and Moshe Aveles. I don't know if you ever heard of him, a very smart guy. Came to my poster and looked at this and said, this is all wrong. And I said, gosh. And he said, well, you cannot use white noise because the real data is not white noise. And he said, what do you mean? I said, well, your noise has to be realistic, has to really mimic the noise you get in real data, because this makes it way much more challenging than using white noise. And he was damn right. I mean, when I started using realistic noise, and I will tell you in a second how I do the realistic noise, the problem was 10 times harder. With white noise was trivial, right? So how can we simulate this realistic noise? Well, it's a very simple strategy. You just simulate the real process of getting this noise. So you have, this noise is generated by neurons that are very far away. So basically what I did from this database of spikes, I superimpose them millions and millions of times, right? So I have a data that is at first flat. I mean, I have a data set, say 10 seconds of data, at first it's all zero. And I put spikes with small amplitude because they are from neurons far away. I put one here of one neuron, one here, one here, one here, one here, one here, one here, one here. And I did this million times, or zillion times. I mean, whatever number you want, but a very large number. So I put in more and 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 more. And then you get noise, which looks like the noise you get in real data, because it is generating from spikes from far away neurons. So this is the basic gist of any method, I will say, to generate the data, to test the spike sorting. You generate noise, on top of the noise you put the spikes, and then you do the spike sorting. And then you can do whatever you want, no? I mean, in your simulations, you are God. I mean, you can do an example that is very easy. It's very easy to tell away this one from this one, very easy to separate. Or you can simulate an example that is more challenging, like this one. All these three spike shapes, they're quite similar. They're quite hard to be tell apart. You can change the noise. I mean, I say here my noise is very small, but I can put a noise that is much larger. So I can do whatever I want, and I can test any algorithm under different conditions. Okay, now we're going to the details. How do we do the simulations? The details will have two parts, because this is chronologically how it evolved. I mean, the first part is what I show you. This was part zero, let's call it. Now, part one of the simulations. So this is the Mickey Mouse model of simulated data, but it works very well. And this was stuff done by Juan when he was in Leicester. And basically what we said with Juan is, starting from the cartoon that I show you, this sketch, this single slide showing you the data processing, low-pass filter, high-pass filter, I told you have a patch of cortex. I say, well, imagine that you have a bit of cortex. And let's divide the problem into three problems. So the neurons far away, like this gray ring, that goes up to, I mean, the whole size of the brain, if you like, this is the one generating noise. I mean, I won't see these neurons because they are too far, but they are contributing to the noise. So let's call this zone 3. Zone 2 is the one of the neurons that are not that far. They are closer, so I can see the spikes, but I cannot tell them apart. So zone 2, this light blue, is the zone of neurons that generate the multi-unit activity. And zone 1, which is the closer to the tip of the electrodes, are the ones that I will see as single units. So these are the ones that I will see the spikes clearly. Now, how can we simulate the three different zones? Well, zone 3, what we did is we say, well, let's put neurons around, let's get a patch of cortex, let's put neurons around, and let's consider, I mean, to each neuron, we give it a spike shape, right, from our database, one of 600 spike shapes. That doesn't matter that much, really, which one. And then let's say the amplitude from my electrode will be inversely proportional to the distance. So the further away the neuron is, the smaller will be the spike that this neuron will contribute to the noise that I'm recording, right? And you can take it as one over D. This is simulating, I mean, if you remember from electromagnetism, this is considering that the charge is a monopole. Actually, it works better if you use 1 over d squared, and this I can show you in some slides later, which is assuming that the neuron is actually dipole, which is a better assumption for long distances. Okay, so basically this is what we did. We put a bunch of neurons far away, and we say, well, the spike of each neuron will be inversely proportional, the amplitude will be inversely proportional to the distance. Now, zone 2, multi-unit activity. We said, well, let's put a bunch of neurons, each of them with different spike shapes, and which amplitude should we use? We don't use 1 over d because it's not an approximation for long distances, but we say, well, we have recordings, we have data, we have a bunch of real data. So let's use the amplitude of the multi-unit activity we see in real data. Let's just take the same values we get in our real data. That will be the best fit for our simulations, for our data, sorry. So I'm basically, in the real data, we get multi-unit, which has an amplitude between 0.5 and 1.5. What are these numbers? These are the number of standard deviations of the noise. That's the value, that's the unit we use to measure the spike amplitude. So you have noise, you have the standard deviation of the noise, half the standard deviation to 1.5 is what we see as multi-unit. And then let's put some neurons close by, and this will be the single unit. Let's give it one spike shape of the 600 we have, and which amplitude we use? Well, the same that we see in real data, which goes from 1.5 to 4. Again, this is what we see in 10 years of recordings. And basically, that's the way it works. And let's start just with the noise. Forget about multi-unit, forget about single unit. Let's see how we simulate the noise and how good or bad we're doing. So if we simulate the noise, this is real data. This is data from humans, and I will tell you later about the human record. This is how the data looks like. I mean, this is how the noise looks like. These are the spikes. This is the amplitude distribution. It's more or less Gaussian, but it has a tail, the Gaussian here, which is the amplitude of the spikes. And this is the frequency spectrum. And more or less the frequency spectrum, if you do a log-log plot, I mean, you heard a lot about power law and sync. I mean, it goes like 1 over f. It could be also 1 over f square or so, depending on the recording. It depends on many variables. I mean, it's not exactly 1 over f. Doesn't need to. Okay. Now, simulations. If you do the stupid approach I did before meeting Moshe Aveles, this is how the data looks like. This is white noise. I mean, this is the amplitude distribution. It's Gaussian. Right, the amplitude, but the power spectrum is flat. You have here a decay because all the data that I'm using here is already filtered. I'm not caring for now, or in this talk, I'm not caring about the EEG data, the slow frequency activity, because I just want to detect spikes. So I won't see whatever is below 300 hertz. So I will high-pass filter the data already with 300 hertz, and that's why this goes down. But basically, it's flat. So it's a bad assumption, Gaussian. It's not really real noise. If you use this trick of putting all the spikes together, ta 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 ta, a million times, I mean, this is how the noise looks like. It's fine. Amplitude distribution is fine. And now the data in the frequency spectrum, I didn't plan to have this. This is what you get, right? You get a 1 over f. It could be vary between 1 over f, 1 over square, depending on how exactly you do the simulation, right? So it's quite good. It replicates real data. But what we didn't like is that here you seem to have more contribution in the high frequencies compared to here. So then we added a bit of Gaussian. And this bit of Gaussian we added is to introduce some thermal fluctuation or some noise in high frequency due to amplifiers and so on. So basically, we add these two contributions, and we get something that looks very similar to real data. And the best way to show you this is to do a little test. Which one is which? One is real data, one is simulation. Can you tell which one is real? Left one. So you are an elf then. Can the what was that?
I'm a hobbit.
You're a hobbit. You're a hobbit. I got it wrong. So the hobbits know which one is which? So left one is real. How do you know it's real? One time I gave this talk and I didn't realize I kicked twice and I keep on asking, how do you know it's real? How do you know it's real? So, yeah, you were right, Siddhartha. So this one is a real data. You know why I can recognize that this is real? Because when we simulate the data, I use the wrong assumption. For a spike sorting, it doesn't matter at all. The times where I put the spike is a Poisson process. I just simulate as a Poisson process. But for a spike sorting, the exact timing of each spike really doesn't matter. I mean, I just want to separate the spikes anyway. So, and the way I recognize which is real and which is simulated is because here I have some fluctuations that are actually not Poissonian. And in my simulations, I always have like a Poisson homogeneous distribution of spikes. But you see, I mean, like the data looks quite similar to the simulated. It looks quite similar even in amplitude spectrum or in the power spectrum. So it's quite a good start. And if I do spike sorting, I mean, if I get this data here and I do this process of spike sorting, which I will tell you later how to do, but imagine this is a black box and it will give me a result. This is what I get. Oh, I don't know which is which now. Can you tell which is which? This is harder. I recognize one because I remember the spike shape. If I remember correctly, this is real. This is the simulated. Yep. So it looks very similar. So it's a very good mimic of the real problem, right? Okay. Now I go to, I will answer your question in two or three slides. I mean, how do I know which zone is which? No, this was a very strong assumption. And we decided to create a more detailed model. And this is what another guy from Spain, Juan was from Alicante, Luis from Sevilla, did in the lab. And the basic idea is, what was bothering me is that we were putting predefined spike shapes. And we were considering single point electrodes. So now the problem gets very nerdy. Because an electrode is not a point source. An electrode has some finite size. It's very small. I mean, depending on the recordings you use, but it goes typically from 10 to 40 microns, which is nothing. But it's not a point source. Then we wanted to see what is the effect of having electrodes or different type of electrodes. So now we need to simulate the whole problem in detail, because I cannot say this is my electrode and I put a spike shape, right? And I see, I mean, I just put a spike shape and it's inversely proportional to the distance or so on. No, because at different points of the electrode, the spike shape from a neuron will be different. And this is because of the slide that I showed you before. Remember that you have all these neurons, and depending where you are standing, the spike shape will be different. Now, to solve the cocktail party problem, neuroscientists use a similar solution that what engineers will use. Well, just put a bunch of microphones, and you have a better chance that if you have just one microphone. Putting a bunch of microphones means that instead of recording with one electrode, you will put many. The most classic one is what we call tetrodes. So basically, you put four electrodes that goes together, and these are very close by. Why does it help? Imagine that I have one electrode here, and I have one neuron here and another one here. And they're both equally spaced to the electrode, and they both happen to have similar spike shapes. So with this single electrode, I cannot tell them apart. But if I have another electrode here, a second electrode, not in between, but a bit closer to the neuron here, well, then it's very easy, the problem, because this one is too far from this electrode, and this one is too near. So this second electrode will solve the problem. Basically, you want to have many electrodes, you want to have many microphones to tell which neuron is which. This is what we call tetrodes, or if you use more than four channels or less, we call it stereotrodes. Now, when you want to simulate this data, so this is a whole long introduction of why we did this simulation. When you want to simulate this data, if I have now two electrodes and a neuron here, I cannot just say that the spike shape is the same in this electrode and in this one, it's just a factor of amplitude. No, the spike shape will be different, will change. So if the spike shape changes, if I want to simulate this, if I want to get this, well, then I need to simulate the neuron in detail. I cannot just tell it's a spike shape. And this is what we did. So basically what Luis did, and this is what we will be playing around in the afternoon, is a code called NeuroCube. It's a GUI, a MATLAB GUI. It's very easy to use, and I will show you afternoon in the evening how it works. So basically, but the idea is, imagine that you have a cube of cortex, right? And you put the electrode here. You can put it wherever you like. I mean, we put it in the center for simplicity. And then we have different problems here. So the first thing, now we consider that the electrode is not a point source, but is something with a finite dimension. I mean, we consider it to be semicircular. You can take any shape you like. For us, this was easy. But basically here, we are considering the spike shape at a grid in each of these points inside the electrode. And the spike shapes are not always the same. They can be changing. Now, the electrode is a conductor material, so it's isopotential. So basically, how do I simulate the spike shape that I will record from these finite electrodes? Well, just do a fine grid, get the spike shape in each point, and then do an average. And this is what you will measure. And there's a second problem, and it's a problem that, thanks God, we didn't have to solve because it's a mess, but somebody solved it for us, or somebody proposed a solution for that. When you put an electrode, you don't just record us with a microphone. You have an interface between the tissue and the surface of the electrode. This interface creates some capacitance, right? So create some funny interfaces effect, and a guy called David Robinson modeled this, in 1968, actually, and he came up with this little model. It's a very simple RC circuit or so that models this tissue electrode interface, and we use this, we took it from Robinson, we use the same parameters as him. All this, which is a mess, you get for free in the code. I mean, it's there, it's implemented. I mean, you just click a button and all this calculation is done for you. Okay, now, when you are close to the electrode, you model the neuron. And for modeling the neuron, I use the same model that Christoph Koch developed with Gary Holt and so on. The same story. I mean, we got it from them. We just get neurons with different configurations, different dendritic trees and so on. We put it in different places. And when we are close to the electrode, and I will tell you in a second what I mean with close, I mean, I will come to this, we just model it in detail. When we are far, we don't want to waste time doing this. This takes really long. So when we are far, we say, well, let's take it just one spike shape from our database, 1/d², and that's it, right? So now we have two zones, two areas. And of course, we can take different type of neurons. I mean, we got, there are not many databases with neurons like this. I mean, we got six, and we use pyramidal cells and interneurons. And the proportion, we try to replicate what is known in the real brain. I mean, you have a proportion of about 20 to 80. So 20% interneurons versus 80% pyramidal cells, 1 to 5. Of the spike? Huge. Huge. So basically what you simulate is each of these pieces of the dendritic tree, you take it as a cable, as a single cable, and then you calculate the contribution of each segment of the cable, and then you sum up, and this is the main thing giving you the spike shape. The axon also gives you some, and the soma also. Okay. Now, how far should we go with this cube? Right, because I put an electrode, and I'm doing a cube, right? But should the cube be 1 millimeter, 1 centimeter, 1 meter? Well, 1 meter is, I mean, the brain is not that long, no? But should I take, so how long should I simulate to simulate the contribution of faraway neurons? So these simulations are a pain because it takes really, really a lot of time. I mean, simulating 8 millimeter squares is huge. But basically what Luis did was basically saying, well, let's see how the noise changes depending on how big is my patch of cortex. So you have 1 millimeter square, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on. Or millimeter cubic, sorry, it's a cube. And basically what you see is that the noise, I mean, converges. And what you get with 1 millimeter here is more or less the same that what you get with higher values. So we took 1 millimeter. And basically this is another important issue. You have to decide how many of the neurons that you have there are firing, how many of the neurons are active, because we know that in the brain, most of the neurons, at a particular time, they're silent. I mean, don't get into this trap of thinking that we only use 5% of the brain, or depending on who you ask, 3%, 10%. This is not true. We use all our brain. But at a particular time, we don't use all our brain, unless we have an epileptic seizure or something like this, right? So the neurons don't fire altogether. So a small proportion will be firing at a particular time. Now, of this patch of cortex, how many neurons we put in 1 cubic millimeter? Well, we know this from anatomy. Let's take 300,000, which is like the density in hippocampus. This is what we use. Now, of these 300,000, how many are active? Well, we don't know. So we try different values. People say around 1 to 10%. So we try different densities, 2%, 8%, 14%. But you see, for any density you take, if you're staying with 1 millimeter, you're already fine. You don't need to model more. And this is a huge advantage because the more you model, I mean, it gets, the time it takes the computer to process, it grows exponentially. Okay, I think that comes to your point. Now, here we have two zones. We don't have three anymore, we have two zones. We said the models, I mean the neurons that are close by, we simulate in detail. The neurons that are far away, we just take 1 over d squared with the spike shape from our database. But where do we put this limit? I mean, how long we take the radius separating zone 1, model in detail, from zone 2. So what we did is to do some calculations by seeing how the spike shape changes as you get away from a neuron. Imagine that you have a single neuron now here. But he's just picking up one neuron of all the mess of neurons. And he has an electrode very close. And now he starts to go away, 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 away. And then what he saw is how the amplitude of the neuron changes as I go away from it. Right? So this is the first plot. And more or less when you get around 150 microns, you converge to a value, I mean, that is getting close to zero. But the most interesting one is this one. How the spike shape changes when you go away. What is the difference between the spike shape if when you start moving the electrode away from it? And basically, when you get, I would say even 100 microns, when you get 100 microns far away, we took 150 just to be conservative, the spike shape doesn't change anymore. So when it doesn't change anymore, well, you just take it fixed. You don't need to model it in detail because you know that, I mean, in your electrode, you won't change anything. You don't need to model it. You only need to model the ones that are close by. So then we took this value. And then we said, whatever is inside 150 microns, we model in detail. Whatever is outside, we just take 1 over d squared. And basically, this is what you get. I mean, this is a validation. Let me just say this plot. This is how the amplitude changes in real, I mean, in the real simulation. And this is an assumption of 1 over d and 1 over d squared. And you see the 1 over d squared match perfectly the amplitude profile you get from the real data or from the real simulation. One of the nice things of having this new model is to deal with a problem that everybody avoids. And the way it was put by this guy Robinson, which is the only one that worked in this problem seriously, was very nice. He wrote a paper, I think it's an IEEE paper, published in 1968, and up to now, 2014, this paper is the Bible. Nobody did anything. Well, there are few people that try something, but they all forgot the problem. And the way that Robinson says in the paper, I think it's even in the introduction of the discussion, I won't read the whole thing, but basically he says, I will tell you what I remember from this quote. He says that the first job of an electrophysiologist, I mean, if you're setting up your lab, you get everything to work, and then you start playing with everything, right? And I don't get good data, so I twist the amplifiers and so on, and then with the electrodes. Key thing. Then you start playing around with the electrodes. Should I get them like this? Should I get them like that? Should I try this diameter? Should I try this other diameter? Should I try tungsten, platinum, iridium, and so on? Should I gold-coated, platinum-coated, or whatever? And you can, and this defines what you're getting. I mean, depending on the electrode, I mean, this defines the quality of your data. But what he says, and it's true these days, I mean, I can nearly swear that it's true for any lab, is that once you get it working, you never touch it. I mean, you never, ever will touch it again. You say, this is working, I stick to it. And you forgot about the problem. But it's quite an interesting problem, no? Because why we use 40 microns, for example? And there's no reason. Well, because this is what we're using since decades. So we keep on using this. And then the question is like, well, but you see the problem, no? The larger the electrode, the larger will be the effective area I will be hearing. If I have a very small electrode, right? Electrodes that people use, for example, for patch clamp or for intracellular recordings, they are very tiny. They are 1 micron or so in the tip. It's so tiny that I would be hearing from a small area around my electrode. So basically what you have to do when you do an acute experiment with monkeys or rats or whatever, typically with monkeys, what you do is you have one of these electrodes and you move it and you hear. And then suddenly you find a neuron. When you find a neuron, it means that you are very, very close to a neuron. You have to be careful because you kill it if you keep going, right? So if you have one of these tiny electrodes, the area you are hearing with this microphone is very small. Well, that's cool because this makes the spike sorting problem much easier because you will be hearing from 1, maximum 2 neurons. And all the rest, you somehow erase it. You don't care about it. But you say, well, no, but that's stupid, no? I mean, I can do spike sorting. I mean, I can sort the firing of different neurons, so I could handle more. And with the same electron, instead of having one neuron per experiment, well, maybe for the same price, I will have five or more. I don't know if I can do spike sorting. Then you say, well, let's get a better electrode. Let's get a bigger electrode. So if you get a larger electrode, say 40 microns, well, you can hear to a larger area. So you will hear from more neurons, right? So that will be a better job. But if you go way too large, you will be hearing from way too many neurons. So then your spike sorting will crash. I mean, you will have many neurons talking to you, and you won't be able to tell which is which. So there should be a compromise of how many neurons you want to listen to. And surprisingly, after this guy, nobody thought seriously about the problem. We keep on using the same electrodes because this is what we learned from Hubel in the 50s. And that's what we keep on doing. I think actually in the paper of Hubel, I think he cites, he has a paper about design of electrodes, and he says it's very funny. He says sometimes, I mean, to some PIs, I mean, some professors that I don't like much, I tell them to use gold because I know this will kill their grants. And there's really no point in using gold. I mean, you can use whatever. Well, not whatever, but. Okay, so that's the problem. So basically, the way we attack this problem, and we can try this if you want in the simulations in the evening. I mean, you can try the code and you can play around with it. We try, for example, electrodes of different diameters. If you have a small diameter, well, you see the spikes very clearly, but you don't see that many, right? If you have a medium diameter, you may have a nice compromise, and if you have a huge diameter, well, then you start losing the spikes. That was actually quite surprising to me. I didn't expect to get spikes with a diameter of 300 microns, which is huge. You will never build up an electrode with 300 microns, but you can still see at least multi-unit activity. So, and then what we say is, we'll do this, we say, well, let's plot the signal-to-noise ratio. So basically, the mean amplitude of the spikes we get from these simulations compared to the noise for different electrode diameters. And I asked him to revise this calculation 10 times because I thought people will think I'm cheating. Because the maximum is actually, for different densities, the maximum is around 40 microns. And oh, surprise, this is exactly what we use in our recordings since decades. Well, since at least 10, 15 years. Just a nice coincidence. Okay, I skip this. And this is the problem I was interested in also in the beginning. I wanted to simulate tetral recordings, and basically we simulate this type of tetrals, which are quite standard. I mean, you can buy them from Neuronexus or other companies. And basically, these are the spike shapes of different clusters. This is just putting the recording from this tetral into the spike sorting. I mean, you don't have to have one channel recording. You can have many. The interesting thing is that you see this is cluster. This is the first neuron, the second, the third, and so on, from each of the channels. And you see the spike shape in the different channels is not just the same spike shape with different amplitudes. The spike shape changes. And this is what you have in real data. I don't know if I will see one. For example, the spike shape here is not the same as this one. Well, this is what you get from your recordings in tetrodes. It's not just a change in amplitude. The spike shape can also change. So it's quite a realistic simulation. OK. You want to take a quick break, or you have any questions about the simulations? Everything is clear? Yeah. Yep.
When you're recording, you also want to know something about the
LFP. Yeah. We have this discussion yesterday. I think you put, well, I don't know, many, some of you will not agree with me. My feeling is you put whatever you want and you will always get LFP. So this is my experience, no? As I say, some may disagree. I didn't quantify it. I think, I cannot simulate LFPs with this one. But my experience is that the diameter of the electrode from microwires doesn't influence much the quality of the LFP signal. Again, some may disagree. This is my experience. Now, I'm purposely not simulating LFP because this is a different ballgame. If you want to simulate LFP, then you have to start simulating interaction between neurons, these conductances, delays, and so on. You have to really take care of synchronization because this is critical to generate LFP and so on. So it's a completely different story. I mean, it's very interesting. We may do it. I mean, we may do it soon. I mean, we may introduce simulation of LSP to the same model, but it's a different story. Okay. How much time do I have, Siarta?
1 hour.
Okay, I will try to not get into too many details then. Now, we can do the simulations. Now we have some tools to test our spike sorting algorithm. So let me tell you a bit about spike sorting. How do you do spike sorting? So when I started in neuroscience, and I saw people doing recordings, they were most of them using the Plexon system. And the Plexon system was doing very stupid things that they changed now. I mean, now the new system don't do these stupid things. But one of the things that really caught my eye was how the experimenters were doing spike sorting. So I was in a monkey lab, and I was seeing the guys doing recordings, and then they will detect spikes, and the spikes, you can see them something like an oscilloscope, if you like. And then people were seeing, experimenters were seeing the spikes online, and then if you see all the spikes aligned, you may get something like this. And by eye, you can tell, well, these are two different neurons, right? It's very easy. So how can you separate the two different neurons to know online which each of them is doing? So the solution of Plexon, which is a solution of many systems, was this window discriminator, these little boxes. So basically, you get the mouse, and you draw a little box around one part of the neuron and another box around other part of the neuron. I mean, this is the spike. And then you do two boxes around two different pieces of the other neuron. You can take as many boxes as you like. You can take one box, two, three, I mean, I don't know. Now, the problem of this is that it gets, I mean, for one channel it's okay, for two channels it's okay. When you get to 64 channels or something like this, it's a nightmare. And people really do that, right? They draw these boxes, and then they run an experiment, and then they're like crazy just adapting these boxes because the signal changes. The noise changes. I mean, you may lose one neuron or so. So it gets seriously maddening. I mean, you can really get crazy doing this. And so spike sorting, I mean, at least in the old times, I mean, spike sorting will be a nightmare of PhD students because you really have to sort your data, and it's a nightmare. Now, there are other solutions, or there were other solutions, from many software companies. This is still quite used. That basically you say, well, you project the spike shapes into some space. For example, say I plot the amplitude, the peak amplitude, against the width of the spike, for example. Or quite a standard solution is to use principal components. You say I plot the first principal component, PCA, against the second. And then you get the clusters. How can you tell which, I mean, how can you separate the different ones? Well, you just get the mouse and you draw ellipsoids, I mean, including each of the clusters. Again, if you have one channel, it's already a problem, but it's okay. But if you have something like 64 channels, 100 channels, and so, this can really drive you mad. I mean, can make you go back to physics immediately. So when I started, I mean, that's my story. I mean, like when I started, I was recording from humans, and that's exactly what people were using. I mean, the stuff that I showed you before is what people were using in monkeys, in the monkey lab where I was. And in the recordings with humans, everybody was using this type of code with 64 channels. And I said, no way, man. I mean, I want to get out of here at some point. So I'm not doing this. So, and that was the state of the art at the time. No? So the problem of this is that it is heavily supervised. So basically, how you draw your polygons or your ellipsoids defines exactly how you get your neurons, and this is very subjective. And there are papers showing that this subjectivity is, I mean, is way too high. And sometimes you cannot draw these boundaries clearly because these clusters will overlap, and you don't know exactly how to draw the boundary. So you are, I mean, you don't know what to do. And yeah, and my idea at the time was like, well, I really cannot spend so much time doing this. I'd rather spend time trying to come up with a better solution so that I can relax. I mean, I'm not doing this whole thing, I mean, all my time in my postdoc. Okay, and this was our solution, or my solution at the time. We call it WaveClass, and it's a clustering using something called wavelets. And this is what we will see in the tutorial. By the way, I do a parenthesis now. There are two ways you can use the tutorial in the evening. Well, maybe it's not useful because you will never see data, but if you're interested in simulations, and if you're interested in spike sorting, you either come and see me doing it, or much better, you can install it if you have a laptop around. Just install the calls in your laptop. You only need MATLAB. It's very easy to use, and you have time to play around with it, and then when I do the tutorial, I mean, you can try it with maybe your own data, run your own simulations and see how it works. I think you could get much more. So I'll tell you at the end of the lecture today where you get this code from. Well, but it's basically from our webpage there. Okay, now let's split the problem of spike sorting in different stages. So at first, for me, spike sorting had three stages. Well, but now we add a fourth stage, which is trivial, but can get problems. So the first thing you have to do is you have to filter the data. I mean, we discussed this, right? You hypothesize filter the data, then you can see the spikes. Then you have to detect the spikes. So here are the spikes that you detected. For example, how can you detect the spikes? Well, you put a threshold, and you say whatever crosses the threshold is a potential spike. Once you detect the spikes, you have to extract features. So for example, you can take the amplitude versus the width. You can take two principal components, or three, or 10, or whatever. I take Weble coefficients, and I will show you a bit later how I do that and why it's so powerful to do that. And then you have to do the clustering. You have to tell, well, this is one cluster and this is another one. And you don't want to be drawing these polygons here. You want to do it automatically. And for this, I use a solution that I borrow from statistical mechanics. And I will tell you a bit later what it is. And then you have your separation. You have your spike shapes. Okay, so let's go step by step. The first bit is filtering. So you get your data with low frequency components. You want to filter your data. Nothing is as trivial as this, right? I mean, you cannot get it wrong. I mean, it's just high-pass filter the data. Well, there are some tricks. I tell you my story. The way I learned this trick, or the way I learned about this, is because I was from physics, I was new into neuroscience, and I started doing this issue of spike sorting. I said, well, I think I have a good idea, maybe using wavelets and so on, and I start doing the sorting using my codes that I was developing, and I was getting all wrong. I mean, like, it wasn't right. I was doing recordings in humans, and these are patients that are implanted with electrodes for clinical reasons, and all my spike shapes, they look like that. I don't know if you can see it from the back, but I will draw it with my finger. My spike shapes look like that. It was like a triangle. And all the spike shapes that I saw in textbooks, that I saw everywhere, that I saw in the guys doing monkey recordings next to me, they were like that. Very smooth, right? Like this. Goes up, then it goes down, and so on. But mine, they were like going up, down. I said, well, there's something wrong. There's something wrong. Or maybe there's something weird with humans. I mean, why do they have spikes like this? And these guys with monkeys, they're seeing all these nice textbook things. Now, the shape I learned tends to be very important because people argue wrongly, that the spike that you see with an extracellular recording is the first derivative of the spike that you see with intracellular recordings. And they say this boundary, I mean, of going outside the cell is kind of like doing the first derivative of the signal. And therefore, this is the first derivative of the intracellular spike. And you get a first depolarization and an hyperpolarization following it, as you do get with intracellular recordings. This is all wrong. You know what is this? The spike shape that you see in textbooks is a filtering artifact. Believe it or not. Let me show you this. There are two ways of doing filtering. There's a measure division of filtering. It's very simple to understand the idea. Imagine that you are collecting data, no? Imagine that the data goes like this. You are collecting online data, no? You are seeing the data, and you get this, you get a spike, pa, 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 you are collecting the data. Now, how you do the filtering? Of course, this data, you don't see the spike clearly because you have also the local fields, so it's all a mess. You need to high-pass filter the data. If you are filtering the data, and if you want to filter this data point in particular, there are, in principle, two ways of doing filtering. You do a causal filter, which basically means that you take a window before the point, right, for setting your filter, or you do non-causal filtering, which means taking a window with the point in the center. Now, all the recording systems at the time, and I think they still do, they do the high-pass filtering online because they do the spike detection online, because then you can see the spikes in the monitor and you can draw these stupid boxes, right? So all the detection systems, they're collecting the data and filtering online. And by definition, if it is an online filter, it is causal. And if you know a little bit of filtering theory or signal processing theory, you know that causal filters, they are well known to introduce phase distortions. What does it mean? That will screw the shape of the spikes badly, right? Now, how can I show you that this is the case? Well, very simple. We have a simulator, right? So what I can do, I can simulate data, I can put a spike shape in my data that I know how it should look like because I put it there, and then I can do spike sorting using different types of filters. And this is what you get. If you use a known causal filter, this means if you get one data point and you filter with a window around the data point, you do spike sorting, and this is what you get. Actually, these are exactly the spikes are put in my... No, this is actually real data. Sorry, this is real data. This is not simulation. If I do a non-causal filter, like center, this is the spikes I get. If I use causal filter, real data, no? This is what I get. If I get exactly the same values, I filter around between 300 and 3,000. And if I increase this value of the low-pass filter, it gets even worse. Right? It gets really bouncy. And this is from 600 hertz. And people are using even from 800 hertz. Right? So this is just a filtering artifact. This is exactly how the spikes look like in textbooks or in the monkey recordings I was seeing from Plexon or other systems. These are the real ones. This is a filtering artifact. How can I prove it's a filtering artifact? Again, sorry, I advanced myself too much. I did the simulations and so on, and I put the spike shape, and I see that I get exactly the same with a non-causal filter, and I see that I get distortions when I use causal filter. Now, this is, again, real data. You like this spike? So this is a spike, putative spikes, recorded with the type of filter people use, say, in the Plexon system or whatever system. This is a filtering artifact. This is exactly how the data looks like if you do the proper filtering. Now, if you apply to this delta thing, which is clearly an artifact in your recording, it was an artifact in my recording, it's a quite common artifact. You get every now and then some pulses, right? But if you apply a causal filter to this, well, it kind of looks like a spike. So you can be fooled easily by doing wrong filtering. Okay. So we are okay with this problem. I mean, no big deal. I mean, the solution is use non-causal filter. If you want the quick solution, if you use MATLAB, don't use the functional filter, use the function field, right? So this is the one-line take-home message. This is a non-causal filter. Okay, we filter the data, now we have to detect spikes. Another very stupid problem, right? Why should we talk about this? You just put a threshold, and whatever crosses the threshold is a spike. Wait. For detecting spikes, you have to put a threshold. That's right. But which value you give to the threshold? And I give a very, I don't know, bizarre value, which is 4 times or 5 times, we use sometimes, of the median of the absolute value divided by this magic number, which only elves know. Right? We say which only an elf knows because this comes from mathematics. And this is the median of the absolute value of the signal divided by this number is a very robust estimation of the standard deviation of the data. We know this from mathematics. Surprisingly to me, this was completely unknown in neuroscience. So, voila, nice trick. Let's see how this works. I do simulations, right? Now that I have my simulator, I can play around, I can play with all my tricks and see how good or bad they do. Now, what people were using for detecting spikes was, of course, putting a threshold. 99% of the people are doing this. You put a threshold, whatever crosses the threshold is a spike, and then you will put this into your spike sorting black box, whatever it is. Now, if you have 64 channels or so, you don't want to be putting the threshold by hand. You want to have an automatic criteria to say, well, I put it here. So what people were using was computing, say, 3 standard deviations of the data. So you get the data, you get 3 standard deviations, boom, this is your threshold. Now, if you take the standard deviation of the data, let's see if you understand this. The larger the spike is, the larger will be your standard deviation, right? And the more spikes you have, so the firing rate of your neuron will also increase the standard deviation of your data because the spikes are quite huge. But you don't want the spikes to be influencing your threshold. You would actually the threshold to be locked to the noise level. And the spike can be much larger than the threshold or just a tiny bit larger. I don't care. I just want to be a little bit above the noise. This is what matters. And whatever crosses this, I know that it's not noise and it's a spike. But the more spikes you have, the larger it gets this threshold. And I don't want that. The trick with the median is that it's very intuitive, no? The median somehow doesn't consider these outliers. This is the trick of a median. And the median of the absolute value of the signal divided by this number is a good estimation of the standard deviation of the noise. So, well, let's use this. I did the simulations, and basically what I did is, sorry, I go back, I put this data, and I put different number of spikes, and the standard deviation by simulation was 1. I just put it to be 1, but I put more and more spikes. So this is the real value. This is how the threshold increased when I use just the standard deviation of the data. This is how the threshold increased when I use the median. So it's quite locked to the real value. It's way much more robust. Let me show you this with real data. This is a recording from Tetrodes, from a lab of Gilles Laurent. At the time was at Caltech, so it was the next lab to where I was with Christoph Koch. And that's a very nice example. So look at this. You have 4 channels, 4 electrodes recording in the locus. And in this case, you have very high spikes, beautiful data. In this case, you don't have spikes. So if you use the standard deviation of the data to put the threshold, these are these green lines. I put it below and above. So this is OK. It's just above the noise. It's fine in the bottom channel. This is also fine. But this is way too high. Well, it's too high because you have too many spikes. I mean, you're missing all these ones here. You're going way too high. Now, if you use the trick of the median, these are the lines in red. For where you don't have spikes, you get nearly the same. Here you get something similar, but look at this. The red one doesn't care about the spikes. I mean, it's locked to the noise level. So it's much more robust. Okay, so 2 tricks. Filtering, use field. Detection, use this median trick, which is very easy. It's just 1 line. Now, the 3rd trick. We want to extract features. So you have a spike shape. You don't want to put your whole spike shape into sorting algorithm. It's way too much data. You want to extract something. Say, get the amplitude. Just put the amplitude and do the clustering, do the classification based on the amplitude. Well, different spike shapes may have same amplitude. Well, just take the amplitude and the width, or just take principal components. I don't use any of these. I use wavelets. And basically, the idea of a wavelet is that it's a time frequency decomposition. Wavelets is a whole story in itself. It's a whole talk, or 2 hours talk. But let's see if I can put it into 2 sentences. Imagine a Fourier transform. You get a spike shape, and you do a Fourier transform. And you get a representation in the frequency domain. Now, the wavelet transform is a time frequency decomposition. Or if you want to be precise, time scale. But take it as time frequency. So basically, it's not telling you the frequency. It's telling you the frequency in time. So basically, if you have a spike shape that has a very peaky spike, well, this peaky thing is something acute, so it's a high-frequency component. So wavelets will tell you, well, there's some high-frequency components at the time of this peak. And then you have a slow decay. Wavelets will tell you, well, there are some low frequencies following this high-frequency part. So it's a time-frequency decomposition. The nice thing is that this decomposition, wavelet coefficients, will catch different features of the spike shapes, of the morphology of the spike shapes. It is a bit peaky there, it is a bit slow there, or so on. And we know that it's a very powerful method. So yeah, the key idea is like, well, let's get some wavelet coefficients that can characterize the spike shape. And let's use this one. Now, let me tell you with one example how it works. I use something called dyadic wavelet transform. So if you have 64 data points for a spike, you get 64 wavelet coefficients. And these are all the spike shapes. I mean, there are a couple thousand spike shapes. Clearly, you have 3 clusters of spike shapes, right? 3 neurons. I put this in my simulation. No, this is simulated data. I do the wavelet transform, and these are each of the 64 wavelet coefficients. And you see that some coefficients, they cluster around different values. Then you say, well, this wavelet coefficient is good because it's having 1 set of values, then another set of values, and then another set of values. Why? Well, because it's picking up the 3 different spike shapes, right? There are other wavelet coefficients like this one here, which is stupid. I mean, it has more or less the same distribution of value for all spike shapes. So this coefficient here is not discriminating anything. This one here, it is. So which coefficients are good? Well, the ones that you have different set of values. And I will tell you in a second how to quantify this. To quantify this, we use a test of normality. How Gaussian is the distribution of wavelet coefficients? If you get 1 wavelet coefficient, and for all the spike shapes that you have, you get more or less the same value, well, this one is not good. It's not separating anything. But if you get a multimodal distribution, well, this one is doing something. So how you quantify this? Well, it's hard to get a robust quantification, but there's something that turns out to work very well. Basically, just do a test of Gaussianity, normality. If something is Gaussian, throw it away. If something is non-Gaussian, well, keep it. Now, you can get no Gaussian distributions also without having multimodal distribution, because you can have a skewness, you can have eccentricity and so on. Well, bad luck. You will get coefficients that are not helping you. But you will catch these ones for sure, because these are really not Gaussian. So how do we select wavelet coefficients? I get my 64 wavelet coefficients. I test how Gaussians they are. And the least Gaussian of them are the ones that are good for me. Right? And I keep 10. You can keep, I mean, whatever number you want. 10 works very well for us. OK, I skip this. Oops. I don't know what I did. OK, let me give you an example of why this idea with wavelet works. Not why. I mean, let me show you with data how well it works. I mean, it tends to be very powerful. This is one of the simulations. I call this example hard, I mean, with some noise level. I mean, I'm showing 1 minute of data, simulated data. With wavelets, coefficients, and then I use the clustering. I will show you later how to do the clustering. I get three different clusters, and this was correct. This was what I had in my data. And I can plot different projections, so different wavelet coefficients against each other. So this is wavelet coefficient 1 against 2, 1 against 3, 1 against 4, and so on. And some projections, you can clearly separate the three different clusters correctly. This was done automatically by the algorithm, no? Now, if I use PCA, no chance. It's all a single blob. I cannot separate anything. You know why PCA doesn't work that nice? Because PCA will give you directions of maximum variance. Directions of maximum variance are not necessarily directions of maximum separability. And there's a very easy example to show you this. Imagine that I have one cluster like this and another cluster like that. Right? So there are 2D clusters. PCA will tell you the best direction or the first principal component will be captured in this, because this is the direction of maximum variance. This is the direction of the largest PCA. But if you get this direction, you're not separating anything. You have to get this direction. And this is exactly what you get with wavelets. You don't get this with PCA. That's why it's outperforming PCA so clearly. OK. Third part. So, and this will revitalize the physicist inside you, because that's statistical mechanics. How you cluster this? How I came up with using this? Very simple, because I know that there's a very smart guy. Well, when I was a physicist, I was working with a guy called Peter Grasberger, who's extremely smart, and he was telling me about a very smart guy that was doing something very good. And if he was telling me there's a very smart guy, I know for a fact this is something. And this very smart guy was developing a method called superparamagnetic clustering. So if you ever talk to non-physicists, I mean, whenever you give a neuroscience talk and I say, oh, I'm using superparamagnetic clustering, they're like, whoa. He's like, wow, he knows a lot. So I didn't do it. I mean, it's something that was developed actually by an Argentinian guy in Israel, Marcelo Blatt, and the very smart guy is Eitan Domani. He's one of the big shots in statistical mechanics. And it's a nearest neighbor interaction algorithm. So I won't get into details, but I want to give you the gist of the algorithm, because it's extremely powerful. So let's see how it goes. Basically, what you do is, when you have the spike shapes, you project your spike shapes into a space of wavelet coefficients. This is not part of superparamagnetic clustering. This is what we did before. So these are the features we extract. You have two clearly different spike shapes. You have two clear clusters here. So now what you do, you apply superparamagnetic clustering. How does it work? Well, consider that these things are spins. And yesterday you saw in the talk in the morning, I mean, there was some discussion about spin glasses. So these things, I hope you remember, because these things may sound familiar. So basically, you assume that these are spin, and you start by giving each point, which corresponds to a spike, a random value. Could be up or could be down, just randomly, right? And now you define an interaction strength between different spins, which is basically given by this relationship here, and it's just telling you it's inversely proportional to the distance. I mean, it's a negative exponential. So the further away they are, the less they interact. And the interaction is only for the nearest neighbors. You say, well, if something is too far, you just call it zero. I mean, don't calculate it. Don't waste time. So take only the nearest neighbors, calculate the interaction as an inverse of the distance. I mean, it's 1 over the exponential of the distance and so on. And the distance is just the Euclidean distance between these points. OK, this is the interaction strength between each of the spins, right? Now you do the following. Now you change the value of one of the spins. Say this one was up, boop, you flip it down. Just you randomly pick one, and you change the value of this. And then you see which is the probability of this change affecting the value of the spins nearby. If I change this one here, of course it won't do anything here, because this is too far anyway. This interaction is very low. So you define a probability of interaction, which is given by this formula. And basically, the only thing you need to know is that the probability of change is proportional to the interaction strength. So the closer they are, the more likely, if you change one spin, you will change the other. That's very obvious. No, it's very intuitive, I think. So basically, what you do, what Marcelo Blatt and Eita Domani did, is if you know about statistical mechanics, they run a Monte Carlo algorithm. They use something called the Wolf method or the Spedersen-Wand method. So basically, what you do is you pick up one point and you change the spin, and then you see how this change spreads around. Which ones will change with it and which ones will not change with it. And the ones that change together with the one you touch, they may belong to the same cluster, or they're likely belonging to the same cluster. The ones that are not changing together, they don't belong to the same cluster. So basically, you measure a point-to-point correlation. You see what is the likelihood of two given spins changing together when you do a perturbation. You do the perturbation many times. You keep on doing this game. You see which ones they change together. And this one you will assign to the same clusters. The ones not changing together, you will assign it to different clusters. So far, so good. But the problem is how you define, I mean, how you get a scale of how strong should be the interaction between neighbors. I mean, if I'm here, if I change this one, well, this one which is very close to it clearly will change. This one which is there clearly will not change. But somewhere in the middle, well, should I change it or not? Well, depends on the strength of this interaction. And how you define a scale? Well, the way they define it is by basically putting all together into this parameter here, which is the temperature. And you saw this yesterday, right? So basically, if you have a low temperature, imagine you have some particles, and the temperature is very low. They get frozen. It's kind of like an ice cube. If you move something, you move the whole thing, because everything is bound to each other. The interaction is too strong. You move one spin, you move the whole rest. If the temperature is too high, all these particles, they're just moving around randomly, because, I mean, they're dissipating. You know, it's very high temperature. So if you just touch one, well, the others don't care. They're moving anyway. So you have different regimes. If you have a very low temperature, you have a regime. If you have a very high temperature, you have a different regime, a second regime. Now, the trick is that if you have a middle range of temperatures, this is what we call in statistical mechanics the superparamagnetic regime. And this is where you get formation of clusters. And this is where you can get the clusters of the different spike shapes. So let's see that. But before seeing that, I want to show you the clustering, because it's really amazing. And this is as hard as an example of clustering can get. It's really challenging. Why? Well, try k-means. Try any clustering algorithm in this. You will fail miserably. Why is so hard, this example? Because the distance between points corresponding to the same cluster, like this point here and this point here, they all belong to this cluster, right? The distance between points belonging to the same cluster is much larger, or can be much larger, the distance between clusters. So with a much shorter distance, you can cross to different cluster compared to going along the same cluster. Another difficult point is that the center of the cluster is not in the cluster itself. The center of this cluster here is here, but there's nothing there. The center of this cluster here is actually on the other cluster. So it's a nightmare. You apply superparamagnetic clustering, and voila, you get it right. Now, if you don't remember, if you don't understand the Monte Carlo story and so on, the key, the gist of the superparamagnetic clustering is that it is a nearest neighbor algorithm. Basically, when you touch this one, you will touch the neighbors, and you will touch the neighbors of the neighbors, and the neighbors of the neighbors. So the way you see it is, imagine these are, it's a forest of trees. If you burn one tree, you will burn the whole cluster, but the fire won't spread. It will jump into different clusters. If you get the right temperature, right? And this is the key. If the temperature is too low, well, everything is bound together. If the temperature is too high, you just touch one and you don't spread the interaction. Now, if I plot the cluster sizes as a function of the temperature, this is what you get. So you get, you start with temperature zero, there's one single cluster. The whole thing is bound to each other, right? You go to a very high temperature and you have thousands of clusters. Each member is one cluster on itself because they're all independent. But if you have a middle range of temperatures, well, you get only three clusters with about 1,000 members each or so, which is what I put in the simulation. So basically the trick is to get this temperature, to get the temperature of the superparamagnetic regime. And this is where I diverge from, where I deviate dramatically from Eitan Domani. The way Eitan Domani proposed to do that is to calculate, well, to calculate the magnetization and then to take the derivative of the magnetization, which is called susceptibility, and then to see for a peak of susceptibility, because this peak of susceptibility will be showing you this plateau. So basically, Eitan Domani was showing for a long plateau, was looking for a long plateau in something, it's not cluster size, but cluster size you can map into magnetization, right? This doesn't work for spike sorting. So the way I do it is a different way. I just start with a low temperature and I have only one cluster. Low temperature, everything is bound to each other. And then I start increasing the temperature, and if I get a new cluster, as long as this new cluster has a minimum number of members, I take it. I say, oh, this temperature is good because I'm getting a new cluster, say, with 1,000 points. That's good. That's a new cluster. Now, but if I increase way too much, I go to the zone of where everything is, I mean, independent, and suddenly I get clusters with 1 point each or 2 points each. And I say, well, no, this is just random. I went too high. So basically, I scan the temperatures, and I get the highest temperature which will give me a cluster of a minimum size. I take, say, 30 spikes or so. And that works. You can recognize that it's a burst because of the distance between the spikes, which tends to be 2.5 milliseconds. And then you get a decrease in the amplitude, exponential decrease. So basically, you see them as three different clusters. But based on the timing and based on the relationship between amplitudes, you can tell it's a burst. Right? The code is not doing this. This is something that you have to do post-clustering. Okay, I will try to skip like 20 slides or so because it's too much. But basically what I did long ago was I used the simulated data and I tested the algorithm and I compared it to whatever else was around. I mean, I took anything that people were doing and I compared it to the solution of using wavelets with superparamagnetic clustering. The detection part was already clear. I mean, with this trick of the median, I was doing much better than taking a standard deviation. And I'm skipping. I'm just showing you this because this is something that if you are interested, you could use. I mean, say if you have an idea for a new clustering method, well, you have the method for simulating data. It's very easy to use. Or you can use this data. This is exactly the data I use in my paper. And many people caught up this challenge and they tried to beat my algorithm. And what I did at the time, I mean, 10 years ago, I just got simulations. I used different type of spike shapes, different noise levels, and I see how I did compared to others. And I did much better than anything else around, much better than PCA, much better than K-means, much better than everything. And I put the data online, so basically you can reproduce all the figures of my paper because the code is also online. And then if you have a better idea, well, if you do better than what I did, well, maybe you have a paper, right? So that's the summary. I mean, these are all the comparisons, but this was only just to tell you that all these data sets, they are available. And you can compare immediately with results that I got and other people got just following this. Okay, real data. I'll give you one example. Well, no, I have two or three. Does it really matter to do spike sorting? I mean, when I started worrying about this spike sorting, I was trying to make my life simpler, no? Because it was a mess to do the thing. And we record from humans, and we'll record 64 channels, and I didn't want to spend my life doing sorting. I just wanted a method that will do it automatically. And it ended up being a very good idea to come up with a new spike sorting method, because this new spike sorting method allowed me to see things that people were not seeing before. right? And I will show you a couple of examples of this. I will show you why it's important to do a good job with the spike sorting. This is real data. This is data from humans. This is like somehow the start of the 99% of my talks, right? I will start talking about humans, why we do recording in humans. In just one line, we do recording in humans because these are epileptic patients. They have electrodes because they're about to go to surgery, and surgeons have to decide where the seizures come from, and so on. So this gives us the opportunity to record single cells in humans. So this is one electrode in the hippocampus. You get four clusters, very nicely. Now, I give you another example. This is, again, real data. This is in the amygdala of another patient. You get three clusters. This is multi-unit. This call it the blue spike, and this call it the green spike. And what I do in my life, I mean, what I do for a living is basically going to the patient with my laptop. I show figures. I show stuff. And I see how the neurons fire to the figures I show, right? I see the visual responses of these neurons in middle temporal lobe areas, hippocampus particularly. So let's see the responses of these different neurons. I show many figures. And this is the raster plot. This is the firing of the neurons. Time zero is here. And the neuron fires very strongly to animals. You see this? Fires very strongly to this monkey, to this mouse here, to the elephant. I'll show you more responses. This is all the blue neuron, right? Fires very strongly to the panda, to the spider. It's an animal neuron, category cell. Now, but we had three neurons. So this is the blue. What did the green neuron do? The green neuron was this one. We just saw the responses of this one. Now we show the responses of this one. Get ready, because this is striking. This is the green. The green neuron is not firing to anything but to the rabbit, to the squirrel, not firing to any other animals, I'll show you more, and to the mouse. So, no. Because I happen to be in Caltech, and I have my nerdy friends from biology that they told me that due to the sexual apparatus of the squirrel cannot be considered a rodent. I'm sorry, I mean, this was the hobbit part of me. I was like, come on. So, yeah, and basically we show about 100 pictures, and the neuron fired only to these three.
Or maybe the patient was not a hobbit, was an elf.
Maybe the patient was an elf, yeah. So basically, the story goes this way. This is very challenging, and this was your question. I don't remember who asked, that I said I will show you with real data. This neuron fired 200 spikes in half an hour experiment, right? This neuron fired 6,700, this neuron fired 1,800. So of all the spikes you see here, a very tiny minority corresponds to this cluster. Now, if I want to put this into mathematical way of thinking, it's not hard to see it. This cluster here in blue is a monster here with 7,000 spikes. This cluster in red is another monster nearby. This one here is a tiny satellite. It's a tiny, tiny thing. What you tend to do when you do clustering is the tiny satellite, you tend to merge with the monster. This is a very typical mistake. And this is what all algorithms were doing. And the cool thing using web with superparametric clustering is that we can clearly get these ones. Now, why this was important? Because these type of neurons that fire very little, we call them silent cells. They are silent unless you show the right picture. In this case, pictures of rabbits. And these type of neurons are the ones that fire to people like Jennifer Aniston, Halle Berry, and, I don't know, Oprah Winfrey, and so on. I don't know if you ever heard of the Jennifer Aniston neuron and so on. Well, the Jennifer Aniston neuron was one neuron like these ones. Nobody was seeing it before. You came up with the right tools for doing the sorting and so on, and suddenly, wow, look at this neuron. I'll show you two examples, and then I think I will stop. Because this is data from Hernan, one of the guys in the lab that just got published. Look how cool. Real recording, these recordings are, the recordings before were in California. These ones are in London. Now we're doing recordings in London also. You get, Hernan got five different clusters from one electrode in the hippocampus of one patient in London. If you just get all the spikes, without doing the clustering, this is what you get. This is the type of response you get. You can hardly see anything. Now, if you separate the responses to the different clusters, this is cluster 3. It's firing to Putin very strongly, and not to all the other things. If you don't do the spike sorting, you don't see anything here. Cluster 5, which is this one, was firing to the Taj Mahal. this is very common. You do spike sorting and suddenly, wow, this one is doing this, this one is doing that. I have tons of examples. Like one spike sorting, one very famous one was found to Halle Berry, right? That was a figure of a nature, a paper in Nature. The neuron found to Halle Berry. The neuron next to it, through spike sorting, guess to who was firing? Mother Teresa of Calcutta. Very strongly. Yeah? Last example, also from Hernan, I mean, the recordings in London. I mean, you get four clusters. You can see that there's something here. This I'm covering the pictures because we use a picture of the patient and of the daughter of the patient. You do the clustering, and this cluster here was firing to the patient and to the daughter. But cluster three, I think, this one here, was firing to George Harrison. So basically, if you don't do the sorting, you just don't see it. After you do the sorting, you see the response. Now, I will skip the last part of my talk, which was basically telling you that spike sorting, I mean, I was trying to convince you of how good is the method that I developed. This part of the talk was basically tell you, plain and simple, that it sucks, right? So, and if this method sucks, I mean, I can tell you because we try other methods, they all suck. They're all bad. They're all doing an awful job. And what Carlos did was basically doing simulations, putting up to 20 neurons. And the guys in my lab, it's something that they know blindfolded is how to do spike sorting. And these guys that are experts in spike sorting, using the code that is supposed to be one of the best, they couldn't get more than 8 neurons. And they were going up to 20. Why I say this? Because I don't want to give you all this thing to say, well, look how good, I mean, we solved the problem, I mean, we're proud of it. No, we didn't solve the problem. It's open. It's still unsolved, right? And people like you or people, some of you may have new ideas. Well, you have the tools to try it. And there's a challenge and there's a lot of reward if you're able to do a contribution on this. So I finalized by thanking the guys doing the work. And in the afternoon, I mean, if you go to our webpage here, you will find the codes, and in the afternoon we will play with two codes. The spike sorting code is called WaveClass, and the simulation code is called NeuroCube. So I will show you how it works. And the last thing I said, if some of you is interested in some of this problem, I mean, we're always, I mean, hiring people. I actually have a position right now for doing spike sorting. So come and talk to me, and you will enjoy Leicester with our nice views and weather and so on. Okay, thank you.
Okay, guys, remember, you know, everybody's supposed to ask at least one question per session. So, you know. Oh, John.
Thanks for a very interesting talk. We have 60 electrode arrays, and one of my grad students got your program, and he's using it, and he really likes it a lot. So it's I can attest that it is better than anything else we've ever run across. However, he goes crazy over one thing, which is the refractory period violations, how you pick that up. So I know in one of your slides, if you go back, you said it was the first one that you start with in most of your talks, where you have the panels of the different spike shapes, and then you've got the refractory period down below. If you go back to that, one of them, I think it was the panel on the far left, it did not have a clear separation. So you're supposed to have a refractory period after the neuron spikes. And so you can't ever make it perfect. No, one before slightly that. Keep there. So right after the cluster plot, it's that second column. No, one more over left. The blue one. I'm colorblind, so I'm sometimes I don't want to say blue. Okay, yeah, that one there. Okay, so that's what? That's oh, okay. So that's not even a that's not a spike. Okay, so you would have refractory period violations. So the go ahead. Yeah, here.
So basically, what you're saying. One criterion that people use to distinguish between a multi-unit and a single unit is to say, if you have a single unit, you cannot have two spikes within less than 3 milliseconds or 2.5. Why? Because a neuron has a refractory period. If it fires now, it will not fire before 2.5 milliseconds. Now, if you have a cluster and you find out that there are many spikes that they fire within 2.5 milliseconds or less, this cannot be from the same neuron. So you're doing something wrong. So this is a signature of multi-unit. And this refractoriness, which is actually what we plot here, zero spikes in less than 3 milliseconds, 9 in 3 than 3 milliseconds, and so on, this is a criteria for separating between multi-unit and single unit. Having said that, this is wrong. This is bogus. Because there's a very serious mistake that people use. This is a very soft criterion. If I have data, like here, the way to get rid of the refractory problem is to increase the threshold. So if I increase the threshold, I will likely start detecting less and less, especially from the multi-unit, because there are a lot of amplitude. So the higher the threshold, the less of these spikes I will be detecting, and the less of the refractory violations I will have. So one has to be very careful with this criteria. That's why I don't like it that much. It's an alarm. I mean, if you do have it, you know that it cannot be single unit. But if you do not have it, I mean, you still cannot say much.